whole subject, the whole medical subject of transplantation is an interesting subject anyway. And I remember as a kid, now, I'm a little kid seeing the, I had this old man, and he used to sit around, and he was a true radio DX nut. Now, he didn't listen to radio shows. That doesn't mean to say he sat down and listened to the A&P Gypsies. He did not listen to Bing Crosby or any of this stuff. He was a DX nut. Now, what is a DX nut? Do you know what the word DX means, any of you out there? Well, the word DX means distant reception. It's an international code sign like QST, QSL, QSO, QRS. QRS means you're talking too fast, Jack. All these various things are international phrases, and the word DX means to listen for a far distant signal. Well, now, there are certain people, the DX cuckoos are a world of their own. And the old man was a DX cuckoo. Now, one thing that all DX cuckoos have that have in common is they're fanatics for keeping records. They don't just sit and listen and say, oh, look, listen, it's Cincinnati, wow. The old man kept very detailed records, and he had these big charts. And he had little cross lines. He would say a frequency, 710. And then he would say, station heard, WOR. And then it would say, city, New York. And then he would say, program heard, guy blabbering. And then he would, time, 642. Position on the dial, 28, or whatever it was he heard this thing on. And he got this radio. See, he used to get up on the roof. I'll never forget the time that he's up on the roof one night trying to fix his antenna. He had this antenna up there. It was a big flat-top antenna that had the lead in down, and he was getting all this crackling on the radio. It was crackling all the time, and he says, it must be my antenna. He says, I'm having trouble with the lead in. He was a true popular mechanics basement type expert on anything. And he never occurred to him that he didn't know anything about it. So he knew all about it. He says, it's the antenna. So he's up on the roof one night, and it was only after he was up on the roof for 15 minutes that he discovered why he was getting crackling. There was a major thunderstorm about to break in the neighborhood, and most of it was about to break in the form of 6 trillion volt lightning bolts into our antenna, which, you know, the old man would have made a great lightning rod, standing up there in one hand with the touching the clouds and the other hand touching the ground, and zap, KDKA. But nevertheless, he had this fantastic thing about DX. Well, I'm always watching him. See, our kid, you know, kids. Have you seen these spots on the radio these days? They're on the radio and they're also on TV about how impressionable kids are. I think it's the American Cancer Society's got this thing. Well, they're very accurate because that's true, and has nothing to do with Freudian problems. Kids just watch the old man. See, just watch him constantly. And the old man, let's say every time he folds his paper to read the editorial page, he goes, brah, 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 brah. Well, the kid's watching that, see. Well, 40 years later, the same guy who was an ex-kid is folding his paper back, and he's going, brah, 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 brah. And the people around him say, well, why do you always do that? He says, well, I've got something on my throat, that's all. What it is, he's got this deep-seated thing way back that when you fold the paper back and look at the editorial page, a little thing goes off in his brain, and it says, hey, Fred, go brack, bromph, bork, brack, brack, craffle. That's what the old man did. When you do that, you're really reading the editorial page, okay? Well, all right, so here, same scene. The old man sitting at the table. He's finishing supper, and he's been shoveling in the meatloaf and drinking the Blatz beer, and he's sitting there. He looks up from the table now. His BVDs are kind of hanging half-mast. He looks around. He says, that, oh, what a meal. Oh, that really hit the spot. Do they use that expression here in the East, the Faith East? That meal really hit the spot. That's a true Midwest. No, I guess not. None of you know the expression, but that's used. It's a common, a continual expression in the Midwest. That really hit the spot. And so he leans back and says, boy, oh, what a great meal. Oh, man, that really hit the spot. Well, the kid is seeing his seat. You know, a real window rattler. You know, the kind that comes right up from the pancreas, and you can just see the Venetian blinds shudder and the walls change color for a minute. You know, well, 40 years later, the same kid, he sits back in his chair at the Horn and Hardart, says, really hit the spot. Wah! You can't escape it. These are the subtle things. And so I'm a kid, and the old man, and this is connected with the whole morality of transplantation. And see, I've not lost the theme. The old man used to sit in front of the radio, scrunched over. We had this Scott. Did you ever hear of a radio called the E.H. Scott? Well, the E.H. Scott in its day, not H.H., now that's a different outfit. The E.H. Scott was the Ferrari of radios in the old man's time. And he, by dint of some judicious pool playing, saving, taking a lot of milk bottles back for the deposit, scrimping, my mother not getting a permanent, thousands of things, he finally managed to buy himself the greatest thing he ever had in his life was his Scott radio. Now, this Scott radio was the name of it. I remember it was called the DX10. DX10. It had a great big dial, airplane dial all over the front that had things that shortwave, police calls, you know, all the sticks. And the old man would sit there some nights and he'd just sit and watch the radio and listen to the police calls. And you'd hear, and the old man says, listen to that. Crime everywhere. And he got to be a great police call fan. He'd listen to the police calls. And then he began to search out esoteric stations between the big stations. Now, most of you guys that listen to the radio, you listen to the big stations. You know, you got your radio, you hear WCBS, WRCA, you hear WNBC, you hear WOR, WABC, and all that. These are the same. But if you were to tune in between, let's say, here, WOR, we're at 710. If you were to tune between WOR, and let's see, NBC is on 660, right? Well, there's a lot of empty space there in between. What you do is tune right in the middle of all that and crank your gain up as high as it'll go. Now, your radio instantly will go, when you hear thousands of voices, it's the Tower of Babel. You'll hear them beseeching. You'll hear them crying and weeping. You'll hear the voices of evangelistic preachers calling for the sinners to get down on their knees. You'll hear guys selling chickens in Tennessee. You'll hear guys plucking and singing guitars. You'll hear organs playing, accompanied by the Hartz Mountain Canaries. You'll hear it all, I'll tell you. Just turn up. That reminds me, speaking of the Canaries, this is WOR, the friendly voice of Broadway. Siri, radio, free bro. By the way, friends, a little note here is kind of a fascinating. When I hear all this talk about the business of the transplant, I remember the old man scrunched down and listening to his E.H. Scott DX10. Well, all kinds of stuff would come in. And I was generally too little to understand what it was all about. It was just all this whistling and hollering. And he used to say, shh, shh, be quiet, will you? And his head is up near the speaker there, and you could hear this voice. And then you'd hear the music, and he's trying to find out what station it is, and he's logging it. And he had these logs called white radio logs. You ever hear of them? Well, white radio logs apparently listed all radio stations everywhere by frequency and by call letter and by city and all that stuff. And he's got this fantastic collection of radio stations that he's heard all over the country. But he became particularly interested in one radio station. And I'm going to award the brass figlegee with bronze oak leaf palm. Because, no, it was not. There was a guy down south somewhere. Now, if you know, we have the idea today, we really do, we believe that we're in an enlightened age more than earlier days. People talk about such things as censorship and so on. Well, there was one guy who owned his own radio station, and he was down south someplace. It was a big 50 kilowatt. And the call letters were the same as his initials. You know, it's like... If your name is Joe Glatz you'd have WJG, something like that. It's a call that's got your own initials in it. And every night, the old man would sit in front of the radio, and this guy would come on. And he had this southern dialogue. And when I heard that spot there with Rod Steiger, you know how Rod Steiger's always playing phony southerners? He just quite make it as a southerner, you know? But nevertheless, he's always playing the southern. He always plays in the same way. And there was this voice would come out, and he had this deep voice, this character, whoever he was, and it was ringing with emotion. He was not a preacher, but he had the same kind of sound in his voice, the same evangelical anger about iniquity and sin. But you know what his thing was that he was bugged about? Chain stores. I don't know, everybody's got something bugging them. And this guy used to come on, he'd just say, friends, radio audience, I want to tell you tonight that the evil that the chain stores are bringing on the ordinary working man of these here United States are not going to come to pass until long after you and I are gone. And the day that comes to pass, all those chain stores, the A&P, who is the A&P? Who are them people, huh? We all know that the local friendly grocer that we've got downstairs, we all know that Fred or Charlie is our grocer. Well, this guy used to go on, the old man sitting there fascinated by this. And he would go on for hours and talk about obscenity. This guy used to use words, I'm serious, the kind of words that even today you just don't see on the walls of the subway. They haven't even gone that far. And I remember one line, as a kid, I'm in the living room, the old man's got the radio going. It's probably the only time in the history of radio listening that mothers would come into the room and say, turn that guy off, the kids are listening. He would say things like this, there ain't nobody up there in Washington with a, what did they call it, the Federal Communications Commission, going to tell me what I'm going to say on my radio, and if I want to say blankety blank blank about them blankety blank operators of them blankety blank chain stores, I'll say blankety blank. Now, if you want to come down here tonight, you Federal Communications Commission, I'll Indian wrestle you any time you blankety blank. The old man is fascinated. Now, I'm not inventing this. This guy became world famous. As a matter of fact, whenever you read trivia questions, all people are always talking about network shows. But this guy had a bigger radio audience than Fred Allen ever had. And his radio station covered the nation like a blanket. I'm telling you, it was like the bubonic plague. He put out a signal. Now, I will award the brass figlegee with bronze oak leaf palm if any of you know the name of this. He has to be in any history of communications. And Marshall McLuhan might not know about him, but man, this guy was a true pop art character. Well, the old man every night would come home, and he got to be a fan of this guy, see. He loved this guy. This guy would come out, he had this deep southern voice. He'd say, and I want all you listeners. He sounded a little bit like a hyperthyroid Barry Farber. If you can imagine, it's now I want all you listeners out there, now all my friends, all my fellow listeners, I want all of you out there to sit down and I want you to write a letter. Now I know a lot of you folks can't write good. Now I know a lot of you folks just can't write as good as you should. But I want all of you to write down, I want you to write a letter to your congressman, and I want you to, even if you can't write your name, I want you to put your X. You put it down on a postcard, and you get your friend, some friend of yours who can write, you get him to write a card saying, I don't want none of them blankety blank, I want none of them blankety blank chain stores in my neighborhood, and you'll never get elected again if you allow that A&P company to come here, and you sign it with your X. And now, folks, it's him time. Well, well, this guy was fantastic. He really laid it out, and he had somebody in his studio there who would play the organ. It wasn't a religious show at all, anything but. It was talk about a blasphemous show. And he used to carry on a running battle with the clergy. And I remember one day, the old man, loved this thing. And he would come on, he'd say, I got a letter here. Now, I want all you folks to listen to this letter. I got a letter here from a reverend. A reverend. He calls himself a reverend. And that reverend says, anybody that talks like you do on the radio must have a soul that is going to burn in hell. Now, folks, I want you... He used to carry on a running battle. And the old man's sitting there digging this whole scene. Well, right next to him. Now, I'll award you a brass big biggie, friends, if any of you out there know the name of this great, unsung, unheralded American today. You know, he's got to be in every radio history. But right next to him was another guy. And I'm just a kid. See, I'm digging all this. I'm listening to the old man, watching him. And he'd tune in very carefully. He had the Scott DX10. Had a very touchy dial, because if you jumped up and down on the floor, he would, move 42 KC, you know, lose his whole signal. And so we had a tiptoe around on eggs when the old man is DXing. And right next to him on the dial was this other guy, who was another maverick in the world of radio. And he had this radio station. This was further south. It was actually in the south, but more west. A great big radio station. I mean, this thing must have had 600 trillion watts. And not only that, they overmodulated the whole bit. You know, this signal came splattering through. And I'll tell you what this guy did. He come on, and he also had a kind of southern accent. He said, folks, I know that a lot of you folks out there have been suffering from aging process. I know that many of you have been going through a change of life. I know that lots of you out there have been wondering just where all the pleasures of life have flown. Well, our new operation, which we are now performing at our hospital here, brings back all kinds of life and vitality to people everywhere. And now I'm going to bring to you, to this microphone, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to bring a patient who has just concluded his operation here, and would you please bring him to the microphone, Sister Ken? There, here, he's coming up the microphone now, and here is Mr. J.G. of Dismal Seepage, Mississippi, who is here to give his own personal testimony on how our wonderful work here at the hospital and at the clinic has helped him to renew his interest in all the life around him. And now, would you please step to the microphone, J.G.? Well, folks, I just want to say that here, God bless the clinic. I want to say that my life has changed 1,000% since I heard about the wonderful work that's being done here at the clinic. And I just want to say, all you folks, please send in that postcard, because it could change your life. I thank you very kindly. Thank you, J.G., and that was J.G. And now, just a moment, folks, our famous warbling birds are going to sing a song for you here. And we got a request. And this guy was on the air across the border, largely. And he was in the transplant business long before the transplant business became popular. And the old man would sit there and listen to this. He's really fascinated by all this stuff. And he would tune back and forth between these two stations. And the two of them would be vying it out, battling it out for the attention of thousands, millions, trillions of listeners. All of them sitting there digging. Well, I'm a kid. Did anybody get the name of the guy? Not one guy. You mean to tell me not one person knows the name of that famous man out there? I can't believe it. Well, how come you know, Herb? Well, of course, you're in radio. You know about this. But he is one of the great unsung heroes. And then there was another one. Of course, these things go on and on. There was another one that broadcast from down below the border somewhere, 500,000 watts. And they're just splattering. And this outfit was like a general store on wheels. Did somebody get it? Oh, yeah? No. Come on. It was not Harold Ickes. Oh, man. It's a great wide world, you know. But there was another guy, and I guess the reason I'm doing this tonight, I suppose, because I was reminded of this when all this talk, when I heard of, you know, the talk of the yogi. There were millions of yogis, by the way, out of the air in those days. And it was one show which I to this day, I can't believe was actually on. You know, this business of the interest in the deep, mystic contemplation of the navel today is a thing most people read about. But there was a show that was broadcast, and it was broadcast pretty much around the country. Now, I don't know whether it was ever broadcast here in New York City, but radio used to have a fantastic variety long before, you know, before they discovered the whole idea of radio is to play records and read the news. But there was a fantastic variety that had nothing to do with Jack Benny and nothing to do with guys like Fred Allen. There was a show called The All-Seeing Swami. Now, I'm not kidding you. And he had an all-seeing Swami church. And it was all, I'm serious, it was a radio Swami all across the country. And this was another one that the old man listened to. And it would come on with an oriental gong. And you'd hear a dead silence. And the announcer would say, "Stay tuned for the mystic Swami who follows in just a moment." And then you'd hear the sound of a gigantic temple gong. And then this voice would come on with an echo chamber. And he would go, "Ala salabakala wala kabalala wajnala wa ala paya lava ya wala gong." Another gong. And then there would be a pregnant pause, and the announcer would once again come in, "Welcome to the Mystic Swami Hour. And tonight, the Mystic Swami, who has been contemplating the great rose-petaled complexities of the eternal universe since our last broadcast, brings you the result of his countless years of meditation. The Mystic Swami, who has transmigrated through hundreds of worlds and lives in the past centuries, now arrives in the 20th century with his meditations in the Mystic Swami Meditational Church." And now, the Mystic Swami. And off in the distance, you would hear the sound of temple flutes. And then the Mystic Swami would come on. He would say, "Oh, friends, those are the simple mystic words of the meditations as we sit upon the limpid pool of life's lotus lake, contemplating the endless, ever-changing, always unfolding seasons, summer, fall, winter, spring. And so I call upon all of you out there in the great mystic distance of the far-seeing radio church. I call upon you to bow your head in meditation and sit in yoga position number 4, which you will find in our booklet we have sent to you, and we wish to thank you for all your wonderful, kind, beneficent offerings, which has enabled us to carry on our mystic meditation everywhere on the radio. And now assume position number 4, and I will read to you from the works of my great contemporary, Masnavasnirika Hodasninjana Raja, who spent an entire lifetime contemplating the infinite in the great mountains outside of Afghanistan. And now we meditate. O lotus, O bird, O sky, O wind, O sand, O soul, O human, O man clothing of her upward, O man always searching, I call upon all
all beseech all, and all humility think beautiful thoughts and wish, upon a bird and a beast, for love and well, and I wish to bless all of you out there in Radio Land. Thank you. Thank you. I meditate now upon all of your soul.
You have just been listening to the Mystic Swami. If you wish to see these wonderful broadcasts bringing meditation and peace of soul to all the radio listeners everywhere, please send a small offering to Mystic Swami in care of this radio station, and to all who send a beneficent offering, the Mystic Swami's own book with his 8 yogi positions, which are often used during his periods of meditation, will be mailed to you free of charge. Stay tuned for the news, which follows in just a moment. Stay tuned for the news. Did you like my little radio show I just did the other? Oh, all kinds of little whoopies.
And there they go, charging ever, charging onward, the charge of the Light Brigade. Ours, not to question, ours, but to do and die.
Where did I dig that clinker up, for crying out loud? Yeah, I know, it's great. Hey, listen, I'll tell you, speaking of that piece of music, you reset that, Herb, all the way at the beginning. That piece of music, you kind of liked the Mystic Swami, didn't you? I can see a lot of people tuning past, you know, in the middle of the show, and I'll say, hey, it's a great show. Oh, that kind of jazz gets them all the time. We're real patsies. But you know that another, speaking of the infinite variety, there was another wild show, which for a while the old man got hung on. He used to listen to this thing because of the insane, exotic quality of it. This guy would come on late at night. Now, I don't know whether or not this was broadcast across the country. Now, this might have been a local show. I don't know. But this guy would come late at night. He would come on maybe about 10:30, 11 o'clock, something like that. And he had a theme that was an organ playing something like, it would come on very portentous. It would come on like, and the announcer would come in and say in a very quiet voice, as this organ is playing Ah, Sweet Mystery of Life, he would say, and now it is time to sleep. This program is sent to you as a public service by this radio station for the countless people in the 20th century fast, hard-hitting world that we all live in who find it impossible to sleep. It was a program to make you sleep. And then, this is where it really got great, though. The guy would come on, the sleep maker, he called himself. It would go, tee, 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 tee. And then the organ would slowly fade out. And this voice that was made out of pure oleomargarine would come on. And he would say, as the organ faded out, good evening, friends. It's time to sleep. Just relax. I want you to turn out the lights now, friends. And a violin would start to play quietly in the background, playing something like the Gypsy Love Song. quietly, sinuously. And then he would begin his subtle hypnotic work, the sleep maker. You want to hear how he did it? I wish I had some soft, sinuous music here tonight. I could show you how this guy worked. But the music played so... Do you have any of that guitar, that cheap guitar music in there? Take a look. Take a look, Herb. I'll show you how he did it. It's a fascinating show. Is it in there? Hold up what you got. I'll point to what I want. Just hold it up. I'll point. Yeah, that's pretty good. Now, look on the back. There must be some quiet, soft music on that. Yeah, just pick any one of them, then. And just make sure, though, it isn't the Charge of the Light Brigade or the 1812 Overture. Get something awful quiet. You know, some nice soft ballad. Because he used to use string music, and he used this very sappy, soft, syrupy type of orchestral music. And the show was... It was a very early form of LSD, actually. You don't have to cue it up, Herb. Just set it down in the middle as long as it's soft music. And here's the way he would work like this. He would come on. Oh, that's perfect. A little fast, but it's pretty good. Now I want all of you to lie quietly. Just relax. There, pull the covers up. Isn't that warm? Isn't that comforting? Don't you feel safe away from it all? You're just floating now. You're floating on a soft green sea. You feel your legs just bobbing up and down, up and down. Your left leg, do you feel it now? It's just floating on the water. Feel it? There. Now your right. Do you feel your right leg just bobbing in the current? Oh, it's so warm, so soft. And your arms now are beginning to drift. Drift up and down. Now you're asleep. This is the sleep maker. Drop in tomorrow night. Just easy. And we'll sleep our lives away. Oh, man. I mean, that's the kind of stuff. I mean, that's the answer to Cousin Brucey, I'll tell you. And his stuff used to go in the old man sitting there.